Good evening, everyone. My name's Jenelle Riley. I'm so thrilled to be here tonight for this cute... Oh, stop, you guys. Mom, you're embarrassing me. I'm so thrilled to be here tonight for this Q&A with the Night Manager. Already a big hit in its native UK, we're so thrilled to have one of the miniseries' stars here tonight. You can currently see him in theaters as Hank Williams in I Saw the Light, and later this month in Ben Wheatley's High Rise. You can also catch him doing local weather reports, or starting April 19th, when the Night Manager premieres in the States. Please welcome Tom Hiddleston. Thank you so much for being here. You are literally the busiest man in Hollywood right now. So
well, there's a lot of weather, so blue skies in LA tomorrow. You'll be pleased to know.
We can bring up a green screen if it helps. Yeah.
Thank you so much for having me, everybody. Nice to be here.
I don't know if you've been like asked to death about this, but how did that even happen? Were you were just at this news station, yeah. And they said, "Hey, want to do the?" I mean, and you said yes.
Well, we did a regional tour for I Saw the Light, and we went to DC and Chicago, and that was our second stop. And I was doing there's a film critic, a local film critic called Richard Roper, hilariously, by the way. I almost rugby tackled him. We were actually talking about Hank Williams, and as I was leaving, the guy said, "There's a huge thunderstorm in Oklahoma. You're Loki, Thor's brother. Thunderstorms, quick!" And then I just sort of pushed me on, and it was live. And I went, "So the weather tomorrow in, you know?" And then I did a weather report, and it went all over the world. Welcome to the internet.
Yes. Not only is there a critic named Richard Roper, there's a critic named Tom Hiddleston.
Yes, there is. Yeah.
And he's a big fan of yours, go figure.
It's interesting. He writes for Time Out London. And he once came to talk to me about Only Lovers Left Alive.
Woo! And, sorry.
Yeah.
I just had to.
Come on. Independent film. And
more like vampires.
Jim Jarmusch. Tilda Swinton. We've talked. And I think people are often... quite confused when they read his film reviews. because they are, hang on a second, just because you're in films doesn't mean you get to write about other people's. There's also a football player called Tom Hiddleston who plays midfield for Hull.
Really?
Yeah.
Do you mean real football or soccer?
Soccer, I apologize. Yeah. Lost in translation.
Yeah. Yeah, I just saw this great quote about Tom Hiddleston is amazing, Tom Hiddleston. And I was like, wait a second.
I'm writing my own quotes now on posters. Every little helps.
No, it's fair. Because this is an audience of SAG actors, I always like to start by asking, how did you get your SAG card? And I know you were working in England for, I guess, years before you started working in American films.
Yes. I got my SAG card on Thor.
Really?
Yeah. Wow. There you go. Loki is a SAG member. I'm not sure if that's a good thing. Do you want him to be part of your union? Member of your union? it was really, I suppose, making that film it changed my life in so many respects. I spent my 20s in the theater in London, and did bits of television and made some small independent films, which I'm still very proud of. America was new territory to me. American film was new territory, and certainly films of that scale. And I was sort of cast in that. And apart from being an incredible role, which it is, and I still think it is, it opened lots of other doors. Got a visa, got a SAG card. It was sort of like I could work in, I could steal everybody's jobs. And that was an extraordinary time. And that was about, let me get this right. That was about 7 years ago now. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, were you prepared? First of all, I have to say, I had no interest in Thor. I was like, it's a guy with a hammer. And it actually ended up being this beautiful, really Shakespearean movie in some ways that won me over so much. And did you know it was gonna kind of change your life, or did people sort of have you prepared for that, or were you in denial?
It was interesting because, you know, it seems it's some, the sort of the presence of Marvel in our culture is so ubiquitous now, but back then there was one. They'd made one film, which was called Iron Man. But there was no cinematic universe. There were no Avengers. It was just so it was. I didn't really. Nobody involved expected it to become what it's become. And the experience of making it was very special. And Kenneth Branagh's leadership was extraordinary. And even on the set, we all felt like we were making something interesting that perhaps people were underestimating, because they thought it was sort of, I don't know, they thought it was going to be some schlocky, maybe you think it is some schlocky thing, but it had a weight and a depth, and it was about, you know, it was good fun, but it also had real drama, mm-hmm. And I hope to, you know, we finished shooting it in May of 2010, And I remember thinking, I think that's going to be all right. I think that'll be a good film. I'm still really proud of it. I think it really holds up. I think there are so many fantastical elements to it. It is an adaptation of a comic book. There's an eight-legged horse and a rainbow bridge. it's true. Just a little pricey. But there are, you know, and it really is down to Kenneth Branagh, because Kevin Feige himself would say. That they were worried about Thor. They didn't know what to do with the property. They knew it was risky and could have been very dismissible and camp. And Ken grounded it in something he understood, which is the family dynamics, as you know, rooted in the dynastic dramas of Shakespearean tragedy. A father and two sons competing. The two brothers competing for their father's affection. And that was all very real, and he took Chris Hemsworth through the journey of Prince Hal and Henry V. So Thor became the wayward prince who has to earn his place at the table and become worthy of his title, and Loki was a mixture of Iago from Othello and Cassius from Julius Caesar, and who else was there? We had Iago, and Edmund in King Lear. I mean, yes, that's right. Stand up for bastards. I'm not just cussing, that's a Shakespearean quote.
But they were ready to rally. Yeah. They're like, bastards! and I mean, it's shockingly good. Like, I remember sitting there watching it, and maybe lowered expectations help, but I think it's one of the best movies.
Thank you.
That's the secret. Thank you. Really.
Thanks. I also think, you know, it's really great because, like, you know, even Anthony Hopkins was I remember him being excited and him sort of explaining how new that feeling was, because I think a lot of people are afraid of directing him because he's so revered and so admired, and less experienced directors perhaps don't want to approach it, and Kenneth Branagh really challenged him. Yeah. And I remember he got very excited by it. He was like a kid, and that was quite palpable, and Chris is just such a fantastic actor, and was so there was so much about that role that he embraced. He completely embraced the physical aspect of it without complaint, which is much harder than he's ever given credit for. And he was also so funny and so warm. You know, it was a good time.
It's really not fair.
Yeah.
So I should obviously get to The Night Manager, yeah. Which is based. Oh, help me, because you say it much better than me. Is it John le Carré?
John le Carré.
John le Carré.
Yeah. His real name is David Cornwell.
Seriously?
Yeah. Yeah.
I can't tell if you're doing a bit or not. That's his real name.
No, that's his real name. Yeah, yeah.
I had no idea.
Yeah.
Okay, I see why he changed it. So this is a novel he did from the 70s. I mean, were you familiar with the material, and you know, how did it come to you?
I didn't. I was in the absolute truth is I was in the middle of shooting Crimson Peak with Guillermo del Toro. Thank you, smattering. Light smattering. Thank you so much. But I can't remember how many weeks in I was in Toronto almost exactly 2 years ago in 2014. And Hugh Laurie and I share an agent in London. And my agent, Christian Hodel, had read the first episode of The Night Manager, which had come in for Hugh, about which more in a second, because he loves this novel, for Roper. And he'd read this thing, and within 5 minutes had sent it to me with the subject title, "It's You." and so it was a very tightly constructed 60-page document, episode one, which I think you've just seen, mm-hmm. and a bit of episode two. And it was one of those, I called him immediately, I read it in half an hour. I was committed by page two. It was so exciting, and I so understood it. It's there's interesting as a you guys all know this, but when you read something, you just instinctively are drawn to it. You think you understand it. You don't have to intellectualize that understanding. You just instinctively know that you can do it, or that you hope you can. But it's I said, how do we do this? And so I called up, and he called. The producers of The Ink Factory, Simon Cornwell and Stephen Cornwell, you'll notice there's a running theme here, who are Le Carré's sons, who now they run a production company called The Ink Factory, which has started as they produced A Most Wanted Man with Philip Seymour Hoffman, and coming out after this is a film called Our Kind of Traitor with Ewan McGregor and... who else is in that?
Naomi Harris.
Yes, she is in that. so they essentially are trying to find appropriate ways of adapting their father's work. So I met with Simon and Stephen and said, I said, I want to play Jonathan Pine, please. And they said, yes, you may. and Hugh had said that, you know, was attached to Roper, and then... And then we kind of, as a team, the Ink Factory then approached AMC and the BBC as a sort of package that this would be something that they might like to be involved in, and that's how it came about. Yeah.
And at what point did the director Susanna Beer become involved? Because she's—I don't know if people know—she's an Academy Award winner for In a Better World.
Yeah.
She's an amazing director.
Yeah. Is it, by the way, just quickly? Is this too loud or too quiet, or you know? Can you hear me at the back? Actor question.
Okay. He can project you now.
I don't need this.
Does this make you want to sing Hank Williams songs when you're older?
Maybe. Maybe not now.
Speaking of, why do I have the one with the label? Nobody cares.
We can swap if you like.
One. Yeah. No? Okay. Okay.
Susanna, she is extraordinary, and anyone who's interested in her work, I would direct you to In a Better World, which is the film she won the Foreign Language Oscar for, and also most recently a film called A Second Chance with Nikolai Coster-Waldau, which is in Danish. They both are. She also... she also directed Brothers originally before it was adapted into the English language, and a film called Things We Lost in the Fire with Benicio del Toro. She's a really interesting director, and she has an extraordinary rigor, a real acuity and precision. And Stephen Garrett, our producer, who used to run a production company called Kudos, which is responsible for Spooks, or MI5, as I think it was known here. Simon asked him to come on and help out, sort of, you know, would he like to be involved in the collaboration? And Stephen had been a fan of Susanna's for a long time and thought that for such a British story and a British writer, I do think Le Carré is one of the most... alongside being a master of the spy thriller, as he is, he's one of the great analysts of the British psyche. And it's in the stitching of his writing. There's something he's investigating about the complexity of British identity, and that underneath the sort of the unifying umbrella of being British, there are many, many different iterations of that, and it's actually more complex than the thing, often than the thing that we sort of peddle as a foreign product. Mm-hmm. You know, that actually our sense of ourselves is much more ambivalent and much less black and white or cut and dried. You know, what does it mean to be English? Is another, because that's a sort of subheading of every Le Carré novel. Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy, or what does it mean to be English? You know, The Night Manager, or what does it mean to be English? Anyway, so Stephen thought that it was interesting to not have an English director, that Susanna was Danish and that she came from a tradition of European cinema that could somehow, you know, rather like Ang Lee when he directed Sense and Sensibility, or Thomas Alfredson and his Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy, this a different lens to the prism of British culture, to sort of to unpack it, you know, all those strange codes of behavior which are codified by class and education and the way you speak and your accent and, you know, why did you go to school and all that sort of stuff. And she brought a psychological precision and a truthfulness. She's very demanding in a very correct way about truth. And so I think she saw her job as, she knew it had to be thrilling. She knew she had to stay ahead of the audience to keep everybody on the edge of their seat. But she also knew that it had to be psychologically interesting. That actually that's what it's about. It's about sort of these complex human relationships, and that actually what is at play is some great seduction. With a huge moral anger. There's amazing moral anger in her film In a Better World. It's about a doctor who works in the developing world in a war-torn, I think an unnamed war-torn country in Central Africa, and he works for Médecins Sans Frontières or something, and you follow him as he goes to do his very courageous and brave work. And he has a son back home in Denmark who's just at school and 8 years old, who's being bullied. And he tells these, she tells these two stories side by side. And there's a sort of anger in the center of which is that there is something flawed in our instinct that we keep fighting. And that this, you know, that the fights that are happening in the playground are happening on a larger scale in this war-torn state, and that they are, we somehow have to, you know, the better world, my reading of it, we've really spoken to her about it, is that the better world of the title is a better world that we can build, mm-hmm. if we fix this flaw within us that we want to fight each other in the playground. Anyway, that's, so she came on board and was revolutionary and strong and changed things. And
was she responsible for...
Olivia Colman.
Yes.
Because
in the novel, yeah. The character of Burr is a man.
Is a man. The character of Burr is called Leonard in the novel. And in a way, he's one of Le Carré's great literary creations. And sort of, you know, he's from Yorkshire and he's no nonsense. And when you read it, you love him. He's got this crusading energy, especially against the corruption in the Secret Service and the CIA, and Susanna just said, I think it should be played by a woman, and Le Carré agreed with it, because he himself was in the circus, as he calls it, and it's as a way of simply reflecting how the world has moved on. That actually at MI6. There are many, many more women in high-ranking positions, and that seemed appropriate. I think it's great. I mean, I can't imagine anyone else playing that part.
Yeah, she's fantastic.
She's amazing, yeah.
I mean, actually, the whole cast is fantastic, and sorry, I've cheated, and I've seen 3 episodes, so I'm a little ahead, but it just gets better, and oh, boo. They don't like me now. But obviously we have to talk about the great chemistry you have with Hugh Laurie. I know you probably didn't get to see a lot of it in the first episode, but...
Yeah, it's a meeting at, yeah. meeting at the end of the first one, right? Yeah.
But it just gets better and better, and I don't know if there's like a club where like smart British actors hang out and you've met before, or you guys went to the same college, didn't you? Is that true?
We did, about 20 years apart.
Yes.
He insists that he'd just left as I was arriving. Yeah,
right.
And we just missed each other.
Of course.
It is amazing that I've worked with him. So I still, you know, I've worked so closely with him now, and we've become friends. But when I grew up, he was a hero, and a comedy hero. He was somebody who was, he and Stephen Fry and Rowan Atkinson were absolutely, you know.
Okay, but they're not here, so.
Okay, but they were heroes of mine. I mean, when he was at the, he was really kind of making waves, especially, and with that group, with Emma Thompson, they all came up together. Around the time I was about 10 or 11 years old, I loved his, they're Blackadders, I loved Jeeves and Wooster, I loved a bit of Fry and Laurie, and I still think it's bizarre that I've worked with him. And actually, Hugh, I think, was, it sort of gets forgotten because now there are so many British actors working here in America and playing superheroes and all that sort of thing. but he was the first, he started it, and it was, he came over and played House, and he was the first, in a way, who sort of, the message that drifted back across the Atlantic is come out and have a go, you know? Whereas I think working in America had always seemed this impossible thing, that you know, you had to wait until you were invited. And so after Hugh succeeded in that role, really, or his, you know, after he was cast and it did so well, it was, people were more intrepid in there, like, well, I'm gonna see, you know, book a plane ticket and see how I get on. Anyway, I think he's magnificent. He is a man of such intense passion and intelligence, and he's intermittently the most irreverent man I've ever met, who's capable of having the entire set, you know, doubled over in fits of laughter, but also deeply serious, and has a deeply has huge integrity, and he loves this novel. He's loved it. When he read it, when it came out in 93, he optioned it, and he wanted to play Jonathan Pine.
So wait, does that make you nervous? Is he eyeing you?
No, he's
wouldn't have been my choice.
Too gracious, yeah. His authority over it and his respect for the writing was such a great thing. It was astonishing for all of us because he was such a keeper of the flame. He was such a champion. He was relentless in his pursuit of it. He would, because Hugh and I were both executive producers on this, my first time, which I really enjoyed, and it gave us more responsibility, frankly, but also inclusion in the process of script meetings and reading drafts and sending notes on new treatments and. Long, tiring evenings around the table, thinking how are we going to do episode 6, and this doesn't work because, you know, in the novel, the Roper's arms trade is arms for drugs with the South American drug cartels, which was very resonant at the time in the early 90s, and everybody, including the Cornwells, David, Simon, and Stephen, agreed that it had to have a resonance for today, so to update it. Pine's military service became the Iraq War of 2003. It had been the troubles in Ireland in the late 80s. And instead of the arms for drugs trade with the Colombian drug cartels, it became arms in the Middle East. And I think it becomes suddenly much more contemporary. And Hugh was always the greatest defender of John le Carré as a storyteller, which is a really astonishing gift to the production. He wouldn't allow easy choices just because it felt like something people had seen before. He used to say le Carré's writing was like Harris Tweed, which is a very Hugh Laurie-like thing to say. but that the Harris Tweed is so finely stitched that no one fabric looks the same. And that's how he feels about le Carré. Mm-hmm. He's such an admirer of the writing.
I mean, he wrote a book called The Gunseller
that is,
in sort of ways, a comedic le Carré.
Yeah. But he's so menacing in this. I mean, he's also so charming. And that's part of why I think it's interesting, because he plays the worst man in the world, but the worst man in the world is also the most charming man in the world. And you fall in love with him because he has all of Hugh's attributes. He's affable and sophisticated and urbane. And you want to be near him. You want to be at that dinner in Mallorca with Tom Hollander sipping champagne and having a lovely time before the kidnapping, probably. Yeah. But you want to be, you know, he seems like a very sophisticated, charming, intelligent man. And as the series progresses, there's this extraordinary contradiction between his appeal, mm-hmm. and his moral nihilism, essentially. That he what Sophie says is true. He trades in death and he laughs, and he is almost created for himself a fascist kingdom. Mm-hmm. And he's cut himself off from society and lives this billionaire's lifestyle with no moral qualms about the victims of the violence from which he profits. And that is what Pine and Burr are so angry about. And le Carré, in fact. Le Carré has this extraordinary anger that comes from hypocrisy. And yet he's fascinated by a character like Roper, and you can tell he's met people like that. And that line in the restaurant in Switzerland, when Burr says, "Why'd you do it?" and Pine says, "Well, if there's a man selling an arsenal to an Egyptian crook and he's English and you're English, you do it." That's straight out of Le Carré.
Yeah.
And Susanna reminded me today that it wasn't in the script and that I put it back on the day, which I'd forgotten.
So you did, I mean, I was curious about your research for it, if you read the book, if, you know, you went to spy school.
I went to night manager school. I don't know how, are you familiar with the Rosewood Hotel in London?
Yeah.
Yes. It's one of the sort of, most frou-frou of the London hotels. A very sort of lavish, and it's a beautiful place, actually. You know, it's the sort of place that Harvey Weinstein has his BAFTA after party, you know. It's massive, and it's right in the center of London, and all your needs are catered for, and there's a beautiful bar, and it's very old, and it's been beautifully designed. And they very generously asked if I would like to be the night manager.
Wait, for how long?
For a night. Yeah.
Did they pay you?
No. No.
So they weren't being generous, I'm just going to point out.
Yeah. But it was so fascinating. The it is like theater.
Yeah.
There is a performance, and then there is a backstage. And the backstage is chaos. And much less glamorous. And the way they research the guests, the diplomacy and the discipline required. I remember there was a wedding taking place in the ballroom downstairs, and the guests on the first floor were complaining about the music. And the night manager incumbent was explaining to me that actually they both, you couldn't prioritize one guest over the other, so they made a note of whoever complained and made sure that they had a complimentary breakfast or a bunch of flowers in the morning, made a little note, you know. And that's when I found out that if somebody asks directions to the bar, you don't say, "Just go outside, turn left," you say, "Allow me to escort you." So everyone feels a bit special.
But wait, did anybody recognize you?
You know, the funny thing is, at night, nobody did.
Are you sure?
Yeah, honestly, at night. And then when people came down for breakfast to sort of pay their bill or hand their keys in, there was just like, "Thank you so much. Hang on. What are you doing?" And I was, you know, wearing the suit and the thing. Yeah, so.
They're like, "Man, Marvel must really pay low. Times are rough."
Yeah. But it was cool. You know, I enjoyed it. I mean, extraordinary. I asked the guy who was the night manager, I said, do you like staying in hotels? And he said no.
Really?
Yeah.
Do you? Now
I do.
You know
I have to.
Yeah.
That's just part of the job in a way. I haven't been home for 6 months, so. No, but that's because it's going well. You
yes.
know, it's a high-class problem.
Yeah, I don't think anyone's feeling sorry for you.
No, you shouldn't. Yeah. You shouldn't. Don't feel sorry for me. I don't deserve it.
But now that you know all the secrets, like when somebody checks you into a hotel, are you like, didn't do that right?
I'm always like, there is like sometimes they do this thing where they try to find out. I remember this thing, there's certain people, there's like maybe a third of the guests of a hotel at any time. If they're checking in, you're supposed to leave their favorite drink on the sort of on the table. And sometimes I check into a hotel and there's a bottle of Jameson. Again, not complaining. but I think I once gave an interview where somebody had asked me what drink I liked, and I'd been to a party that was sponsored by Jameson the night before. So I sort of said Jameson, so now I'm kind of like, every time I change it, there's the Jameson. You know what I mean? Someone's done their homework. But it's amazing, they've got these records. I mean, they know more than the CIA. They've got records on everybody, you know, all their guests, what they do for a living, where they live, how often they stay, are they special guests, you know, do they like to keep a low profile? And yeah, it was amazing, really.
I'm curious because, you, like much like you, I worshipped Hugh Laurie for years, especially because of Blackadder. And it was very strange when he started playing smart characters.
Yeah.
Because he was always a buffoon up until then.
God, he's intelligent, though. It can be intimidating because he's so sharp.
That's what I was going to... I mean, was it intimidating working with him? Or I mean, you've worked with Anthony Hopkins. Do you ever get intimidated?
I'm so respectful of the work, he is amazing, Hugh, what he's done even in his career. He's done so many different things, and his brain is so big and so incisive and insightful. But that kind of thing, it only made me want to sort of win his approval and. But we got on very easily, actually, from the first moment we met. He can be very funny. We met for lunch in London about 3 weeks before we started even talking about the development of all the scripts and stuff. And we sat down, and it was a very grey January morning, and he said, right, good, okay, so we'll be doing this. And within 10 minutes he said, I mean... do you have any idea who you are? And I said, well, I think so. I mean, that's sort of the journey of life is to discover it by, you know, in you know, you sort of, with every year that passes and every experience you have, you think you get closer to something. How about you? And he said, absolutely no idea. No idea. He's so it's just very sharp, very sharp and very funny, and kind as well, yeah.
And what ended up being the hardest part of the shoot? Because it is, I mean, I almost even want to call it a series because it's like a movie every week. And actually, there was a question from the audience about this. I apologize in advance if I butcher anyone's name, but this one's Melissa, so it shouldn't be too bad.
Hi, Melissa.
I wanted to know, as an actor with a lot of recent film experience, how was making the transition back to television? And sort of like, you know, what did draw you back to television? Was there any hesitation?
Not at all. I mean, I always think that the distinction is so much easier to make for the audience because the way it's delivered is different. You know, if you watch it on TV, you can watch it in your living room or on your iPad or however it comes to you, where it's different from getting in the car and driving to the theater and watching a movie. But this felt like a film. The experience of it felt like a film. It was just a 360-page script as opposed to a 100-page script, you know. It was, and I think that's actually the answer to the question, is that was the challenge, is we were shooting out of sequence. And for such a tight thriller, to stay across the detail and to stay on top of where Pine was and which version of Pine. I mean, haven't got, basically, he goes undercover And he has several covers, and he's called by at least four different names in the course of the 6 hours. Truly a spy, a pretender, somebody who is concealed behind a new identity and then observing from that vantage point. And so for Susanna and I to keep track of where exactly he was and how much he could reveal and what was going on inside him, especially because we shot in four countries, Switzerland, London, Morocco, and Mallorca. And we did episodes, sort of episodes one, five, and six before three and four. And sometimes I was in sort of pretty much every scene, mm-hmm. and I would have to go from something very physical for 5 hours on a Thursday night, and the next morning go toe to toe with Hugh in something with psychological intensity. That was just the stamina of it, really, and to keep going and not drop the ball. And we shot it in 75 days.
Wait, really?
Yeah. So 360 pages in 75 days.
You like to do things kind of ridiculously fast, because I know I Saw the Light was also a
fast
shoot.
38, yeah. 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 130 pages, I think.
And doing like two musical numbers a day sometimes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, like a challenge. Sometimes it's good not to have too much time, because then it gives you too much time to think. And, you know, I'm in a room full of actors, you need to be true to your instinct. And if you're given extra time, you can doubt yourself. Sometimes you don't need that extra take. You need that first one, that second one. Kenneth Branagh actually told me this. He said, it was a real gift. He said, just so you know, some actors need to warm up, and they're fantastic in their fourth and fifth take, and there's nothing wrong with that. They just feel their way through it, and they hit the target around take four. That you're not one of those people. You know, when your work is good, it's good in the first two, because I can see you're prepared. I mean, it was just a nice thing to say, because not everyone is as honest as that. He said, sometimes you think you need another one, but you don't, because actually the first time you do it is riveting, and the second time you're aware that it's riveting, and you try to do it again, and you can't, you know? which is really... which is just very generous in a way. It's a useful thing to know, because not sometimes actors, I mean, as we know, directors aren't, they're not sure of what you can give them. And so they keep going in case you've got more. And it was, by that time we'd worked together on stage in London, we'd done a television series, we did Hollander together. We knew each other very well, and I trusted that was coming from a very generous place. I don't mean to repeat that immodestly. I don't think of it as any great virtue. It was just good for me to know, because sometimes when you're shooting very quickly, there can be a sense that maybe you left a stone unturned, because there's only a certain time in the budget to get. You know, you've got to get through seven pages or in the day before the light goes, and so you can't linger on stuff, and you get to the end of the day and you think, did I investigate that sufficiently? Was there another choice to be made there? And it was his way of saying, don't worry about it. It's probably going to be all right.
I mean, you've worked with so many amazing directors. You mentioned Kenneth and Susanna, and you've worked with Steven Spielberg and Woody Allen, all in the same year, actually, now that I'm thinking about it. What is it you hope for from a director when you show up to set?
That's a great question. I think you just hope for sort of a great partnership. And I feel very reassured when I see that they have a great relationship with their DP, and they have a real authority over their image making, is that you think, okay, I'm in really safe hands here, very clear instincts. That's always reassuring, and of course, I think. And then, but in the collaboration, what you want is a conversation that's where you can talk about how a characterization and a performance can align itself with the tone of the whole thing. and every moment is another piece in the jigsaw puzzle of that, and that you construct those moments together and you share secrets in a way. I felt that very much with Susanna, because she and I were in every day, and Pine's almost in every scene, and sometimes we would know things about Pine that nobody else knew. And she was the only person looking for them, because everybody else, of course, has a very technical job to do, or a practical job. Focus puller, grip, gaffer, you know, the sparks, all those guys have such technical jobs to do. And Susanna's the only person watching for like, that thing we talked about last week, nice, I see that, you know. So yeah, you just want an open and fruitful conversation where, and also it's fascinating when you hit bumps in the road and how you manage that. Susanna and I rewrote a lot of stuff on the fly, because we would suddenly find the location didn't appear to be what we thought it was going to be on the page. The scene wasn't working, and in that moment you have to work together very fast, because the sun is going down, the clock is ticking, and so you think, well, how does this really work? And that becomes quite exciting work, because you've got the sides in your hand, but you have to rewrite them and you have to come up with something fresh. And I've had, you know, Guillermo del Toro is like that. One of my favorite scenes in Crimson Peak, we just wrote the minute we shot it.
I remember hearing about this.
Yeah. I don't know how many people have seen that film, but
spoiler.
Great. Okay. Thank you. Bless you. Thank you.
All right. How many of you paid?
Nice. Bless you. there's a scene where the truth is out, and and everybody knows everything, and Mia Wasikowska is trying to escape the house, and Thomas Sharp has turned and he's trying to make it right. And he comes up the elevator, and Mia's Edith, tries to stab him immediately with a pen. You know, how dare you? And in the script, Guillermo had written this extraordinary speech of confession, a confession of guilt. And it was very poetic and very open-hearted, but very, very speechy in a way, very, very eloquent and wordy and constructed, and suddenly he just said, this doesn't feel right. It's not because of what you're doing, it just isn't immediate enough, it feels too eloquent. And we rewrote the scene, and it became, Edith said,
I know the scene, you want to do it?
You know the scene?
I do.
All right, here goes.
Can I be you?
Okay.
Okay, because I didn't know that part.
How does it start?
You killed women.
No, yes. You killed three women.
I did.
You poisoned me.
I did.
You said you love me.
I do.
There you go.
I'm not going to say I was better than Tom Hiddleston.
You know what?
But I mean, like, to make it that simple, and I can't imagine many actors saying, we should cut my lines.
Yeah, well, if it's, you know, if it makes it work, it's better. If it's better, then you've got to do it. Yeah. There's so much of that that's cut, actually. I think the last time I cared about my line count was in the school play when I was 13. Yeah. I've got more lines than you. I've got 953, and you've got 807, you know. Anyway, yeah, sorry.
You mentioned that Night Manager came to you, I mean, not only as an offer, they were like, you're doing this, basically.
Yeah.
Do you mind if I ask, how long has it been since you've auditioned for a role, or?
Not long, actually. I auditioned for a role which I won, and then I turned it down, and I can't tell you what it is, I'm sorry, because it feels like it's sort of just come out, and I don't want to sort of tarnish their performance.
You don't want George Clooney to feel bad, knowing he was the second choice?
Yeah, I auditioned for The Revenant, but I thought I'd let Leo do it. no, Stop it. Stop it. No, I didn't audition for The Revenant. It's a joke. It's a joke. Please don't put that out there.
For the bear.
For the bear. No, but auditions. I have auditions sometimes. It's usually if someone, either a director or a studio, have a sense that it's a different kind of role, that actually they're not sure if they can see me in that role because there's no previous example of it.
Wait a minute, you just played Hank Williams, which like nobody would think of you for that. Two rave reviews, might I add.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much. At the back, appreciate it.
How many of you paid to see that?
That's all right, it only just came out, you've got time. It's playing at the Landmark, we did a Q&A there last night. Mark Abraham, who's a very distinguished producer and filmmaker in his own right. This is what's so fascinating about the side of the business that is less often reported, is that I first read the script for I Saw the Light about 2 months before Avengers came out. And so in terms of my sort of exposure to American audiences and to the industry, I was much less well known, I suppose, people didn't know who I was so much. And Mark had seen War Horse, and in the scene, there's a scene where Captain Nichols buys the horse from Albert.
I know this scene too. Do you want me to do it?
No.
I promise. Sorry.
I promise you, man to man, that I'll look after him. Oddly enough, he turned to his wife, his now ex-wife, as he tells the story, and said, "That guy just looks like exactly like Hank Williams." And she said, "Does everything have to be about Hank Williams? Can we just watch the movie?" But then he looked me up and he watched The Deep Blue Sea and he watched Midnight in Paris and I think he watched Thor, and he sent the script to my agent and then he sent the script to me and I read it and we Skyped and we spoke on the phone and then eventually we met for dinner, and every conversation we had felt like a deeper investigation of what the collaboration might be. And his great pitch was that he wanted an actor who would sing. He was never going, because I had said to him, "Look, these are big boots. I don't take this responsibility lightly. He's an icon." And he said, "No, I think it's actually, I need," it was The Deep Blue Sea, I think, that he took as my audition, because that was about the complexity of relationships that aren't working. And he really wanted to make a film about that to draw together the power of Hank Williams' songs with the intimate relationships he had with women, which were volatile and turbulent, so that in his marriage to Audrey Mae Shepherd and his love affairs and also his relationship with his second wife, Billie Jean, the passions and the pain that came from those relationships were what gave him his inspiration to write songs like Cold, Cold Heart, or Your Cheatin' Heart, or I'm So Lonesome I Could Cry. And that was his great supposition, was that these songs came from something in Hank's own life and his rough and tumble relationships with women. And I enjoyed the premise. He talked about his heroes. He talked about Bob Fosse, specifically Lenny and all that jazz. And he talked about Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, obviously, legendary portrait of a marriage by Mike Nichols and Edward Albee, and those were his touchstones in a way, those three movies, and a bit of Raging Bull because he loves that movie so much. And it's all again about people sitting in a kitchen having an argument. Jake LaMotta was gifted, but you'd see very little boxing in that movie comparatively. Mm-hmm. It's really just De Niro getting in a fight with Kathy Moriarty. And it's fascinating. And so he was like, that was the Hank Williams he wanted to know, was the Hank Williams in his kitchen fighting with Audrey, who was then contrasted with the Hank Williams up on that stage and being a star.
So do you mind auditioning? I mean, you must be good at it. I don't know if you've ever had any bad experiences.
I was terrible at auditioning. I think I still am. I may have got better at it. I was once told, actually, by Michael Grandage, the theatre director, I was in a production of Othello, which is one of the great and happiest experiences of my whole life, at the Donmar Warehouse. A Chiwetel Ejiofor played Othello, and Ewan McGregor played Iago, and Kelly Riley played Desdemona, and Michelle Fairley played Emilia. And it was one of those productions where every role was perfectly performed, and I played Cassio. And I remember auditioning for it, I so wanted to play that I learnt the entire part before I went in, because I wanted Michael to be able to call upon any scene. And then on the first day of rehearsal, he called me aside and he said, "Can I have a word at the end of the day?" And I thought, "Oh God, I've lost the job. I'm going to get fired." And he was very generous. He said, "Just so you know, you did a great audition for this, and you won that." And I didn't know Michael. He said, you auditioned very well for this, and I'm happy that you're in the production. But what you've done today is twice as good as what you showed me in the audition. So just so you know, get better at auditioning." because I'm pleased that it was good enough to get you the job, but what you've done in here today is much more interesting, and I don't understand why you didn't show me that in your audition. And it was a very generous thing for a director to tell me, and I wondered why that was, and I thought maybe there is a, I don't know how everyone else feels about auditioning, but there was a holding back in a way, sort of like, you know, you don't get to try before you buy kind of thing. which is a really obstructive attitude as an actor to have.
But great for dating.
What's that?
It's great for dating.
It's great for dating, yes. Keep the powder dry. I don't know. I was sometimes, I've done some good auditions. I knew my audition for Thor was good because I trusted Ken. Yeah. And it was the only time I felt like I'd auditioned for everything. I remember auditioning my first time in LA. I auditioned for huge movies and small movies. I auditioned for the first, I arrived in LA on early January, my first time ever in the city, in early January 2009. And I auditioned for a film called Hesher the next day,
sure,
which was then played by Joseph Gordon-Levitt. And it was just awful. I mean, it was a train wreck. My audition, not the movie, by the way. I just wasn't ready. My accent was all over the place, and I didn't know how to find the place, and, you know, LA traffic, jet lag. I auditioned for John Carter years ago, and...
The movie John Carter.
Yeah. I never saw it, actually, but they were big, sort of... They were billed as big opportunities. Of course, yeah, they were. And I was auditioning, I was doing pilot season, and I remember I was driving, I had this rental Camry, Toyota Camry, and I would audition for all the pilots. And I realized I'd never have time, because I had an apartment in Venice, and I never had time to go, because I realized you had to sort of dress as the character, whether it was a doctor or a lawyer or a cop or a fireman or whatever the thing was. So I would drive around LA with five shirts in the back seat, and then change depending on whether I was going up for the doctor or the government insider or it was the policeman or whatever. It was a very bizarre experience, but good training, yeah, actually. And it was really like audition boot camp. And I went back to London, took it much more seriously, I felt very grateful to American casting directors who just, maybe it's different now in London, I think, but at the time, their program was just much more polished. You know, if you auditioned, you were reading with an actor. You weren't just reading with somebody saying, "And why did you have to treat me that way?" You know, and they had proper, you know, they had proper lights, and they were really, you know, it was really great. So I got better at it, thanks to Michael Grandage.
I think we are out of time, and I know you have to be somewhere, so I'm going to ask everyone to stay seated while you get out of here.
Okay, but, I can stay for a bit longer. Honestly, I can.
Can we take some...
If you can, yeah. Okay, I'll do another 15 minutes or so.
Okay, well, let's do some audience questions then. Well, this is a Shakespearean name, Cornelius. Where are you? Is that your real name? I love that name. Okay, maybe you're shy, sorry. Wanted to know if there was a specific moment when you felt you made it as an actor.
I don't think you ever feel like you've made it, really. It's such a... I really have learned that, actually, is that the only security is in your commitment to the work, because you never know... You know, you never know what's going to happen to a project. It could be championed, it could end up in the bargain bin, you know. And so the only security it's a really interesting, it was very humbling when The Night Manager came out in the UK, because I was in Vietnam. We spoke, actually.
You can just tell everyone that.
we spoke on the phone on a Sunday. I was finishing the shoot for Kong Skull Island, which is coming out next year for Legendary and Warner Brothers. We were in Vietnam, which is a very, very beautiful place. Thank you. but it was very... We were in quite sort of... remote locations, and it was quite physically tiring. You're running away from the great ape every day in a swamp, and every Monday morning I would get lovely emails from Simon Cornwell and Stephen Garrett about the previous episode on the Sunday night on the BBC, and it was quite humbling to read that, and then at 5 in the morning. And then put on a wetsuit and go into this swamp, you know, in Vietnam, which is, you know, kind of like the novelty wears off after about an hour. there are all kinds of bugs in there crawling into places you don't want them to crawl into. True story. And that was quite humbling. It's like, I was talking with Scott Sakamoto, actually, who is a tremendous camera operator, and he shot The Revenant. And I was—he was the main camera operator on that—and he came onto Kong, and we were talking about that, and he was in waders with his Steadicam, and I wasn't in waders, and we were like, our phrase became "there is only the swamp," you know, somewhere, no matter he, you know, because he, the Revenant had just cleaned up at the Oscars, and there he was back in the swamp in a way, so it was, you know, that would just became a nice little touchstone. There'll always be a swamp somewhere.
What are you working on next?
Thor 3.
Oh, will there be swamps in that?
I don't know, actually. Back in the habit or the helmet.
I have a question from Blaze Fury.
Hi.
Oh, for some reason I thought it would be a man. I'm a horrible sexist. wants to know if it's hard to leave a character behind when you're done that you have no further commitments to. And I love, I'm so sorry, Ruxton from...
Oh, William Buxton.
I'm
from
sorry,
Cranford.
I'm the daughter of doctors, and I still have trouble reading handwriting.
thank you. It's interesting, there's always a... As much as I would never call myself what has now been construed as a method actor, so I don't stay in character throughout the shoot. Not because I don't sit in judgment on that process, I just know it doesn't help me. There's always more of a shadow or a residue than I think there's going to be. The focus puller for The Night Manager, Justin, who was such a tenacious little guy, it was such a small crew, and he was South African, and towards the end he was going, Tom, I just don't know, man, like, I feel like you guys, at the end of this, you should just be put in some solitary confinement and have a debriefing by the CIA just for a week. and it felt like I needed it after this, because it was quite stressful, which is not the complaint of a sort of bleeding heart. It was just a long very psychologically intense shoot. And if I had any residue from it, it was that I actually felt some small hint of the real stress of a field agent. You know, this oddly, I felt the loneliness of those people. And le Carré talks about this in his writing, is that the obligation, and I think the reason spies are enduringly fascinating, is that we're all compelled, I am compelled, by the moral courage of that decision, that you choose to live outside of society without the privilege of intimate relationships with whom you can share yourself. You have no identity. You are, to all intents and purposes, invisible. And if anything happens to you, nobody knows about it. All in service of a higher cause. And it's a deeply lonely profession, I think. And all of le Carré's heroes have that solitude in them. And oddly enough, at the end of the film, I had felt a bit of that. So it was nice to go home.
Now, I have no poker face whatsoever, so I would make a terrible spy. Do you actually think you'd be a good spy?
I think too many people know who I am now. What are you doing here?
Aren't you the night manager?
I'm a spy. No, I think I think I'm an actor, so I think we're sort of we're all quite open people. My experience is that actors are always very open, and that's what the job is. And I think you could never be, you would have to be someone who was more comfortable with being, you know, with having your closest feelings remain unknown. I've always thought that would be very lonely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So probably not.
Question from Brandon.
Oh. Hi, Brandon.
Wants to know, who's an actor or director that you dream of working with?
Oh my goodness. The list just gets longer with every passing year. Gosh, it's hard to single them out, really. You never quite know. You know, it's all, I always feel like I don't want to count my chickens, because I think if I say it out loud, it might never happen. but I can tell you a long list of directors I deeply admire. Christopher Nolan.
Oh my God, you'd be perfect for a Christopher Nolan movie.
Well, you can tell him if you want, Jenelle.
He doesn't like me.
Okay.
I'll tell him not to hire you, and then okay. He will.
Martin Scorsese, Paul Greengrass. I'm now just blanking on everybody now. Alfonso Cuarón, Iñárritu, of course. Oh dear. Those are the ones that come to mind. But then there's every year there's a new film that comes out when I think, my God, how did you make that?
You just worked with, it's been a little while, but you have High Rise coming out later this month, which
yes.
I'm just going to throw out because I love this movie so much. You worked with the great Ben Wheatley.
Yeah. The great Ben Wheatley. He's great.
Are you guys working together again? Or?
I'd love to. He's so prolific, and he writes and cuts, and he's always working on something. He just is. He has such a creative engine, mm-hmm. and he works with his wife, Amy Jump, and they write together, and for the most part he shoots, and then they cut together. But she doesn't do any press, which is why less people know about Amy Jump. But they really are a team, and he's cutting Free Fire at the minute, or finishing it. Which is a film with Armie Hammer and Brie Larson and Charlotte Copley, and then he's writing something else. He's got so much on the boil. I'd love to work with him again. It was High Rise, as chaotic and insane as it is. It's an adaptation of the Ballard novel, so it has all of Ballard's provocation in it, in its DNA. It was a very happy experience because Ben, that's just who Ben is.
Now, this is Craig. I don't know if anyone's seen the movie, because it is brutal and dark and hilarious in kind of a strange way. But it was fun to make.
It was. I think it's weirdly sort of just loosely, it's about a high-rise building in the 70s in East London before its regeneration. And it's a sort of project designed by an architect with a grand dream, played by Jeremy Irons. And so members of London society of a certain stripe, dentists, doctors, broadcasters, documentary makers, people who work in PR, gynecologists, they all move in and they buy a 1,000th share in the cliff face. And Ballard describes it as like an ocean liner disappearing over the horizon, where every inhabitant can live according to his or her own law. And at first it's very seductive, it's very glamorous, lots of parties, all mod cons, this fantastic new thing that they have called recycling, two swimming pools, a supermarket. The idea being that every possible need is catered for by the building, by man's substitute for nature. And it is very glamorous and sort of seductive initially, but then slowly cracks start to appear and neighbors get territorial about garbage sacks being left in the corridor and cigarettes being dropped from the upstairs balcony, and why is the electricity being cut off on the lower floors and it's still on the up floors, and why is the swimming pool only open to children at certain hours? And basically it becomes a sort of petri dish where the English class system sort of devolves into a feral state. And J.G. Ballard, in his inimitable way, does not stop until its end point. So we sort of returned to a more feral, brutal, new society, and people start, you know, physically fighting and over supplies and rape and murder, and it's very, very dark, and that's all there in the novel. It's a fascinating novel. It's fascinating through, if you're a fan of Ballard's work anyway, it's another sort of intellectual experiment, I think, where he is working something out about his own experience, I believe, as in Shanghai, when it was occupied during the Second World War in a prisoner of war camp. And the way he describes it in his autobiography is he saw so much contradiction. He would see extreme violence and cruelty followed by extreme kindness, and it didn't know how to make sense of it. But as I say, it was enormous fun to make. and I think it's because there's something about the characters in that film are free of a sense of propriety, and they start leaning into the indulgence of their appetites. And there's nothing actors love more than that. So there are lots of party scenes that begin as huge fun, and lots of dancing and music and jokes, and that then get out of hand. And I think just sort of trying to construct the chaos of those scenes was really enjoyable to stage. And Ben himself is such a sweet, kind man, and he has such an air of no judgment about him that encourages you to be braver, mm-hmm. in a way. I remember one scene. I have to carry one of the principal characters into a swimming pool filled with coffee beans and shopping trolleys. Which has become a charnel house. And he set a track along the edge of the swimming pool. And there was huge nervousness about me breaking my ankle by stepping into the pool with this man on my shoulders. It was fine. And I had to demonstrate it by essentially stripping off and showing the ADs that it was health and safety approved. And then we sort of shot it in one take because we didn't have time to do it again because everyone was going to get wet. And on the other end of the swimming pool, I sort of found this aerosol can, and we just kept rolling because he hadn't called cut. So at this point, my character Lang is in a hell of a state. And he's feeling so unclean because he's surrounded by so many dead bodies. And I picked out this aerosol can, and I didn't know if it was a prop thing or anything, and just sprayed it into my mouth.
Oh, God.
And it was a can of real aerosol. It was the most disgusting thing I've ever done. But it was one of those moments where he'd created a sandbox, you know, an environment, a playground where you just felt very free and where, you know, anything goes. And that environment, you know, when you're working with a director like that, that's meat and drink.
I want to let everyone know that film, it's weird, I know these dates, but it comes out on video on demand on April 28th.
That's right.
Hits theaters May 13th. Mm-hmm. Night Manager starts on AMC April 19th.
That's right.
I Saw the Light is in theaters now.
It is.
Thank you so much for being here tonight. Thank you guys for being a great audience.
Thanks a lot. Thank you.